10 seconds remaining.
Welcome back, everybody, here for our second and last series of the night. It is NaVi going up against 4C&L to see who will be able to get themselves into that playoff position against the boys. Well, yes, boys. I say the boys. I'm just like, why am I saying just the boys? Look up the golden boys. Like, it's the G boys. Get the prompt before I say anything else, which is stupid as crap. Alright, in we go. Drafting time. NaVi will be on the Dire side. 4C&L over on the Radiant side is a star-studded lineup from both sides. Of course, a new set of stars over on NaVi, even though really all they did was change was one player in and out. But we are still casting them anyway under the tag of their rebuilt NaVi side. Of course, joining me is Ryu. Welcome back, man. Welcome back.
Glad to be back here. You, Toby. I mean, you're saying more stupid stuff than me now, so...
It's terrific. It's terrific.
We're brothers.
Lord of the Rings is Star Trek. A boom! Mind-blowing. Yeah.
I mean, did you see Aragorn's acting? It was just as bad
as... You're jealous. You look like Matt Damon on Aragorn. Like,
I love Aragorn. That's my favorite character. I hate on him.
All right, so let's see what happens here with NaVi and 4C&L. Now, obviously, everyone's talking about NaVi. They played their first game, first series after the disband last night. Is when
I
they
saw
played,
that.
Where they won their first game fairly convincingly,
and then
got very convincingly trashed in game two and game three. So, really, it was rough. Sunra played extraordinarily well. Just want to flag that throughout their entire previous series. But everything else seems to be pretty standard. Like, they've got their stand-in, always want to fly. Sonako, Dendi, Sunra, Didira.
Call him Didira.
And Funnic. So everything is pretty much the same apart from always want to fly and Didira being in NaVi now.
Oh, always want to fly, go back to Empire. 5 seconds
remaining. So really, all that actually happened was a force was kicked.
Yeah.
But it was made to seem a lot more dramatic than what it actually was.
NaVi's never gonna have a Dota 2 team ever again.
Yes!
That was basically
what was said. Like, everyone's just like, oh, well, is Dendi finally leaving NaVi? And there were so many people out there who were just like, yes, finally! He can go out and be part of a team that actually succeeds in things and, like, yay! Like, maybe he could be part of a Western team. Maybe he could travel to China and be part of a Chinese team. Like, Tommy, Dendi could broaden his horizons. Oh no, it's funny. Dendi and Snake are still back. But I mean, they only lost on Force. Because Artstar was obviously kicked earlier on. So.
Let's just not talk about the salt and the wounds.
There's no salt. There's just a lot of, like, I felt like I was sold a pill which would instantly make me slimmer. But I'm sorry, still Tubby One over here. Like, it's false
get
advertising.
That Rogaine for that hair? That hair loss? No, I don't think
I have no hair loss.
I know.
I have a full head of hair. It's very, very good. And I'm eating better and doing exercise more now, so... One won't be around for much longer. Enjoy the meme while you still got it, boys and girls. Let's talk about a draft, man, because it's already pretty much underway. Once again, the Doombringer is being banned out. This is now our fourth game in a row this has happened. Same for the Shadow Fiend in the first two. Queen of Pain has slipped through pretty early on. The Huskar ban seems to be very unique, however.
Yeah, the Queen of Pain normally you see will interchange between Darkseer or Nightstalker. And surprisingly enough, there's no Wisp yet, or Wisp ban, which is... I think it's a really good combination with the Nightstalker. Especially when you can just run at the enemies constantly all the time. And it's great for Ember Spirit too, just because that's how they like to play. They like to play up in your face. So NaVi needs to be a little bit worried here. I think banning it out would be beneficial.
Radiant team. Well, they're not going to do it, man. Witch Doctor and Slaughter is on the hit list. And the pick, it comes the way of Sexy Bamboo. Recently, I heard Blitz claiming Sexy Bamboo is one of the smartest people in Dota. Maybe not life, just Dota.
He's pretty fun to play with.
Yeah, he seems to be really cool. He seems to think of new and inventive things before everyone else does. It's kind of cool.
He's like half YOLO. You know, at times he's just like, oh, let's just go screw around.
Unless it comes to Roshan, then he's full YOLO. like if there is any chance to steal an Aegis of the Immortal, he'll take it. Like, there isn't even a question mark in his mind. He will take that chance. So you got your Wisp.
I don't want this. How about that? Alright, so now what is Na'Vi going to do to counteract this? You've seen AA is pretty good for dealing with Wisp. I mean, that's pretty good for dealing with the other two heroes, but not when Tiny comes out. Kind of have to... I don't know. Were they predicting that Ember would be mid? You can't normally think like that. Nightstalker is going to be handled either in offlane or support. Io is going to be coupled with another hero, most likely. Either it was the Necro or the Tiny. And Razor's not gonna do anything to that once the combo comes out between... So liking the Razor pick.
This is one of those things like Denny tried to run it yesterday too. Well, Sudeikis tried to get Denny to run it yesterday. It kind of feels very cramping in style to run something like a Razor. You got to get your timing 100% right.
You have to have push too. Yeah, you have to have great push and presence, else you're just gonna get ratted. Is the easiest way to say it.
But where do you get your push on a Razor? Like, you're not gonna be building an Aghanim Scepter on a Razor, so it has to come from your other cores.
And winning the early game isn't as, you know, as great as it once was. So you have to also think about into the mid game, trying to siege these tier 2s, trying to siege the high ground. I mean, that was the story of two patches ago. Sniper, high ground, how do you break the base 70, 80 minutes in the game? Now you're just like, oh well. Is Wraith King the answer here? It's just like a 5-man lineup. I mean, if 4 Clovers just split up the map constantly, I just don't see how they can really get picked off.
It seems limiting in many ways, this Na'Vi lineup. This is one of these lineups that I would expect to try and run, like, aggressively into the Radiant jungle before, like, the runes have spawned. And go for early snowball kills kind of style. Like,
yeah,
just run
exactly.
An aggro tri lane, put the Razor in the mid, put something like a Broodmother up on your safe lane. They could try and win the lane there, but...
I think they'll do Razor plus Wraith King mid, maybe. I think they'll dual lane against the Wisp Tiny. I think that's what I'm looking at. Tusk will be off lane, Rubick will be that support, and then they'll try to get another good carry for this situation, and I'm not really sure.
Wow. There was no hesitation from either side with these picks. They knew exactly what they wanted and just went for it. Alive
into
the Phoenix. Yeah. It is. That's a number one position Wraith King.
I wonder if it's going to be the Radiance Wraith King.
If it's a Radiance Wraith King, this game is one for 4C&L. Like, just putting it out there. Like, it's always that thing where you see a hero pick up Radiance, and then you wonder, okay, so you got Radiance, but what effect does it really have? With a Wraith King, he's got to be on the front lines and attacking, which means he's got to soak up all the damage. Reincarnation is the only thing that will bring him back to life, because the Radiance means he's got no other items which give him strength to survive the fight.
Yeah, you need Blade Mail. You need Blade Mail and Blink. If you have those along with the Radiance, it's really good. Then you can potentially get a refresher, and then you're that frontline tank. Because they don't really have any mana burn on the other side. Like, there's no way they can really chew and they can anti-mage or PO with the Fusil. They don't really have the best ways to deal with the Wraith King ultimate, so as long as he can get to that later stage of the game, but he's just single target, and single target without a BKB, burst damage against a Tiny is non-existent with Craggy. It's just, you're not going to be hitting.
Yep. Good luck.
Okay, man, you're frozen. It's like looking at Dusa. Frozen in place.
Right, so laning wise, NaVi will not be running this Phoenix as a core. In fact, it's a support Phoenix with an offlane.
What?
With an offlane Tuskar Phonic. Is what they're doing. Thoughts?
30 seconds to battle.
How do you make a support Phoenix work? Like, what's the plan behind Naco picking this? Because he picked it with no question in his mind he wanted this. Didn't care what 4C&L were picking. They picked up their Wyvern. Boom! There was the Phoenix.
Yeah, it's really weird considering they have good counters to that Nightstalker and Nighttime attack speed bonus and IO with the charge on into the Ember or Tiny. It's... I don't like it, and we'll have to see how it works, because if I've learned anything from the past, it's that Sunako is one of the best support players, especially on Wyvern, and I hope he can prove us right that, you know, maybe Phoenix can be good too, so. It was kind of, did you see what he did too? He put down his boots to help with the blocking, and then now he has them.
I wasn't watching that. I was watching the shard play from Funic on bottom lane, which blocked two creeps. And then he tried to body block another one and just slipped around him. So that didn't really work. So Sunako is coming in with an aggressive ward. Look at the Radiant stacks. So he's trying to keep tabs on what happens with the Wisp and Tiny. And potentially now bottle snipe.
Yeah.
Except he won't bottle snipe, he'll boot snipe.
No!
Did they see him? Yeah, they saw him.
Yeah, that's... Mistakes were made.
Yep. So, tether forward, actually cuts the tree height.
Well, maybe not.
He might still kill
the...
No! No! Sunako! The damage from the tower, he tosses the Wisp in! First blood's gonna get an AGM and then he counts Korea inside! He actually gets the other Korea! This now classifies itself as a disaster! That was not the plan!
Pycat's locked up in the bottom lane here. No aggro on him yet.
Then again, Phonic kind of trapped in there with him because Nikwa had the shards available. So we're looking at another trade-off. So you lose Pycat, and actually, Nikwa backs up from this. Dendi lost his life in the mid. It looks like we get another dive in. Sunako jumping forward, but the tether fall from EGM, it can't do enough.
What is this game?
It's scrappy. It's scrappy do, man. It's scrappy, scrappy do.
It's just players making great plays everywhere. That's what it is.
Now, time for Nightstalker. Steal said rune. EGM comes in to help him. Wow, that void damage on Sunako. It definitely helps when he goes for the fire spirits and always want to fly. They're going to come back in. They keep that slow because of the tether straight through him. EGM being picked up and thrown on top of the hill. At the same time, Denny being tossed around like a ragdoll by Bamboo. The tether will bring EGM back down again. The Blaster Field will get the kill for Dendi. The sexy Bamboo is still punching him. EGM will have to go for the last hit, giving now Wisp a double kill. And in the space of 2.5 minutes, the Wisp has found 4 kills out of the 5 for 4C&L.
I do not even know what just transpired right now. I'm just happy I'm casting this game, Toby. This is quickly turning into just a slugfest. And IO, man, does he have? Okay, so he has an urn already. Urn early on with him. He doesn't have overcharge. What? What? Okay, this is kind of weird. Normally you see IO have...
It's combat build Wisp, man.
You need to get overcharge at level 3, no matter what.
Dude, this is EGM. Like, there is no questioning EGM's builds on Wisp. Like, you only learn, you don't question. Dendi. The avalanche and toss. He's really trying to manipulate this early attack for Dendi. Still dropping so low. Bamboo can't go for more. EGM, he's burning up. Wisp will actually find that kill. If the bonus damage wasn't there from the spirits, it wouldn't have worked. Tiny. He's wanting to chase. He's got Avalanche off cooldown now, but the combo isn't really there. So, is with stick charges. He needs to punch him, however, once, or he can have the Nightstalker rotate in for one last void, making it now forcing out a 2-for-1 trade-off after losing the Wisp in mid.
Yeah, but I think the balls did help a lot during that, but they would have gotten more attacks off.
Nice dodge. He actually went in for the snowball, which dodges from the blast of Nikwa. And with very good bottle charges, he'll survive on 19 life. And this will invite Taneko to chase after Nikwa. Nikwa needs more life here. The Fire Spirit's coming out. He'll burn out at the moment. So far down. No, he lives on 12 life. The spirits were not enough damage because we still have to keep in mind this is a support.
He's getting dope.
Phoenix, and yep, they're coming in behind the tower. Wyvern denies himself the neutral creep, and then he gets tossed around once again by this Tiny.
I mean, this is just great play coming in from 4CL. Like, what is a. They're just having a Phoenix sit mid, but that's not enough to help out Dendi, it feels like. They need to have always want to fly with TP, I feel like.
Oh, no. He snowballed. Bottom lane, Phonic. This wasn't a dream. You have a Nine Stalker rotated. It's nighttime and you're initiating into Pycat, who will now slide a fist you down. The movement from the Nine Stalker was perfect, and these aggressive wards, like the one aggressive ward they put down to watch, like you play an aggressive lane like a Phoenix doing what he's doing. And you put down a ward to try and watch, like, stacking and farming of stacks. Which means then you don't see anything in the bottom river area.
I'm scared now. Look at Sexy Bamboo. He's got 1800 gold. Is he gonna get a fast blink dagger and just one-shot everybody?
Yep. Second what Bamboo does too. He's going after Dendi. There's a lot more support here, always gonna fly in the neighborhood. These Whisper Balls have been soaked up mostly, and EGM trying to become a little bit more of a sponge Dendi. Okay, that Urn is gonna tick him out. He knew he was gonna die. Bamboo still dies as well, but almost every hero of NaVi has come to this middle lane. The only one who has failed to rotate every time is Dedera. But you cannot blame him for that. He's 42 for 9 on the CS. He's looking very good as that Wraith King.
He's the only person who's actually CSing in the game.
You have Pycat. Pycat is 30 for 11.
That's still very... I mean, just because Pycat went down early on to the Tusk too, it really hurt his CS. That's why he's so far behind and dives.
You are right, though, that he's the only person who is not involved in any fights. He's just focusing on the lane itself.
And... Well, we can see that actually hitting CS will get you the top net worth. But Wisp is definitely up there. He's got like 6 kills.
The second to fifth position, man.
I know. I was just.
And now Ruby's
they're gonna steal too?
Yeah. Pings are coming out. The pings are coming out right now for Fiends. It's like, yo, boys. Our home insurance has been taken away, Phonic. Nice little move up, actually dodges the avalanche, won't toss the toss. And those spirits from EGM are still doing some serious work, but he needs to get that tether back up again, which he does not have, which means Sexy Bamboo, having all the damage drained out of him, doesn't stop the Nine Stalker from coming in and punching him, but allows Dendi to finish up the job over on Bamboo.
That's just diving a little bit too deep when there's wards and vision up. NaVi didn't have any wards up scouting that, then they could have potentially done it, but... Still having vision here, it's really helpful, once he gets his blink dagger, it's going to be looking really good. I wonder if he does rush blink. He'll either go blink or blade mail, I think. He's going to be gone on top lane. He could be in trouble. He hasn't skilled up his ultimate either yet. No, now he just did, so that's good. Holding that point just in case it'd be a suicide.
They want Phonic. Look at the movement speed from this Dire Stalker with the phase boots as well. He just wants to punch Phonic down. He'll be denied, however, because of the snowball. They come back out of it, but Bamboo comes in. They actually burn the reincarnation. The Tusker might be dead. EGM regenerating up, bringing that Night Stalker back from the grave. And they go after Didira once again, punching him down. Nikwa's attack won't be enough. Bamboo's fist, however, will be. And behind the tower, they also found out Snake's Phoenix. Where are you, Dendi? Walking home.
He just cleared out the stacks in the jungle.
8-minute blink dagger. It's an 8-minute blink dagger on Bamboo. It's the dream for Bamboo. And I think Dendi's dead. Nine Stalker comes in with a Void having EGM behind him. The Wisp Spirit Balls are enough damage. And that is a very easy pickoff. You might have taken out the stacks, but you're still sitting at the 6th highest net worth as the mid Razor.
It's just looking all ogre at this point. I mean, it's not over just yet, but like their lineup just scales so much better in the late game too. It's I'm just not understanding what NaVi are trying to do. They're trying to go for, you know, kind of like lane dominating and bottom lane. He doesn't have any mana, so Pycat's not gonna, but he had a double damage rune.
Yeah.
So.
Full one charges, so we could have gone a little bit harder, but There's no reason to it. Like, you just drop Funic down low. What's he gonna do? Like, you bottle charge up once. Funic is still so scared, and this top play. Now you gotta relocate Wisp now. Like, it's not even 10 minutes in. You got a level 6 Wisp up and running. So you gotta relocate, save, or a potential get even more aggressive with relocate.
I mean, if you have relocate at 15 minutes in the game, you're looking good. Like, that's around the time you normally see the Wisp do, just because they're doing all this stacking at the times. They're letting their carries get a little bit more experience and sacrificing their own, but...
Man, if
10 minutes is like unheard of.
If you have a Night Stalker, who in the second daytime phase is still walking around with 4 kills, 1 death, and 6 assists. He is the top net worth on the field. He's actually beating the safe lane farmer as this Night Stalker.
It's just perfect play execution. They're just rotating around, like you said, the first
time. Fly, you don't want to do this. Bamboo, blink forward. Fly, trying to throw Bamboo on the cliffside, but that won't work. Then he can't pull enough damage out for him. They walked underneath the Observer Ward. Always want to fly, will die. EGM already has the urn up as well, so all these kills just give more and more ammunition to 4C&L.
This is just going to be painful. I'm going to have to cover my eyes.
Dude. Don't look away.
Don't look away. This is brutal. And if he dies right now, Bamboo? What? Okay, yeah, that's an easy kill.
There's no way you can TP in for that. Like, if you think you can fade ball to creep wave back when Bamboo has a blink dagger, he will go you every time. And you almost have to assume as Na'Vi too that there is good observer wards all through their own jungle. Yeah, you put down 2 sentries to try and get rid of this, but... Okay, they're going top.
Relocate.
Yeah, they're coming off the raid thing. A blink forward from Bamboo. He blinks just far enough that he doesn't actually break the tether either. This game is quickly being lost for Na'Vi.
They're setting up a mid lane here.
Yeah, but EGM can just tether away. You're going to snowball after him, but you got Winter's Curse available here for Niqua. They cold embrace over an Io, and now you actually trigger Nova. You toss Funic back onto the Radiant side. Io may die, but there's your curse, locking down Funic. Keep it any control for a moment. Bamboo does not have mana to play with, so the Fiends is enjoying this, chasing up after him. Baker, however, is maybe not so enjoying this. He's already burnt through his Nova. His Icarus dive didn't give him any advantage because he came straight back again. Dendi has to stand his ground and battle Pycat. He'll be protected by this cold embrace. No slide of fist just yet. He's got Siri changed in 1 second, but it was too long. Now you're Night Stalker. You're almost top net worth on the field. Try and chase out Dendi. The plasma field does considerable damage to 4C&L, but the split blast, it doesn't reach Dendi, but it doesn't stop Bamboo. He just runs up. EGM spirits. Bamboo was actually a vessel for EGM to pawn. And now he has to get himself away. There's a double damage rune in the bottom river, but is it worth it? EGM's gonna tether down. He'll end up bottling that up. Bringing Bamboo back up to life as well as mana and always wanna fly. Well, gets a good pickoff over on Bamboo. But now they toss in the Wisp. EGM taking out the Rubik. He activated the double damage rune, so that is a blue Wisp who now has to try and stay alive up against Funic. Won't happen as he gets Walrus punched down. And Tuska, only 389 gold for that kill. EGM feels like he's worth so much more.
Yeah, they could be making some potentially big plays, but Rubik being only level 4, it's just hurting him at this stage of the game. If they could reliably steal Winter's Curse, maybe they could turn around the team fights. But when they don't have that, when they're not getting off a good Phoenix, like the only way I see this synergizing well is when Wraith King dies, and then they Icarus dive over the top, and they put Fire Spirits and use the egg. Like, that's the only way their lineup synergizes.
They're going again. Relocates on the wave. They silence up Dendi. Bamboo needs to get this kill before support will arrive, and Dendi just punch him once more. Oh, the snowball, it protects Dendi. It's chasing after the Night Stalker, however, and EGM gets the balls out. The Nova will come down. Dendi is already down. Night Stalker cannot be protected long enough by this cold embrace. The stun will connect, but no, he lives at 140 life. Wants to earn back up again, but Phoenix will be there with the support from the Fade Bolt. Didier Ra is chasing after Bamboo. He needs to force up. He needs to get away. The Sun Ray will come. He turns around for the Avalanche toss, but... Oh, Didier Ra will end up surviving through all of that. We're 20 minutes. We have 40 kills in 14 minutes.
And Bamboo went up worse then.
Why not? It's a fighting positional game.
It's just so funny. It's like I'm so far ahead I can buy anything and win. I mean, I can win Dagger.
He's jumping mid. He's going for always on a fly. He's burning to the flame guard. There's nothing more he could do there. And then you actually find another target. It's going to be Funnic over in the tree line. Snowballs protect. Who's he going on? EGM or Pike? And it's EGM. And EGM just keeps his spirits in close. And finds the kill over on the Tusker.
Always going to fly is level 6 now. This is where Na'Vi turned it around. This is... It's their time to shine.
Is it?
I mean, they kind of need a mech too on Dindy, but... I think he's going mech. I think he's... Probably going for Sanger and Yasha. I don't know. He needs a BKB though. That's if he doesn't go for a mech, he needs a BKB. Still, this is. I guess you could say the biggest thing is that Tiny is not transitioning into a. Well, he's dead, but. I just watching Bamboo because it's so fun. Yeah, it's just you know something's gonna happen. Look at that four staff. He was baiting out the Tusk Snowball too. You can see that's a really good calculated play there from Bamboo.
Yep. He knows what to look for. He knows what Na'Vi's arsenal is. So in the meantime, just beat down these tier 1 towers. Take up objective by objective. Your next nighttime begins in 30 seconds. I'm still looking at a Nightstalker who's almost got Nag in him Sept and we're not even 20 minutes into this game. How is Na'Vi meant to win a fight when they can't see a fight? Until they're dead. You'll never know.
You just blindfold the enemy team.
Yeah, basically. The Zerbwald also understands that Wraithing is farming. You can kill him and put that reincarnation on the cooldown. That's still worth it because it's such a long cooldown time. And where do you go? Like, you got your armlet. Good luck toggling that one with the Wisp Spirits in so close. There goes your reincarnation. They snowball in. EGM will get punched down. And Bamboo and Nikwa, this isn't the greatest position in the world for them. There is still that TP out. Nikwa cannot Arctic Burn himself away. He can Cold Embrace himself and maybe buy a little bit of time, but that's all. And actually, he really should have. Yep, he gave away Cuss. Always want to fly.
Alright, this is the comeback dream right here. It's happening right now. How much gold did they get from that? They got 1600 gold swing. All right, and who did it go on? It went on only Tusken. Still too much, but if you think about it though, Sineko has the Midas and he's not looking too bad himself, but the rest of his team is definitely struggling.
Highcat wants to go bottom lane. That reincarnation is still on cooldown for another 108 seconds and look for the relocate. It's coming in, but Bamboo starts with a double avalanche toss. Actually repositioned Na'Vi before that fight began. And Na'Vi wanted to fight. They came in with three of the smoked heroes for this, but they couldn't reach him. They just push him forward. There's that force up from Bamboo, actually pushing the Nightstalker closer. Now they're able to reach up. It's a good stolen curse from always want to fly, but where's the follow-up damage? You get a stolen toss. Funnic still getting hit with pebbles. Sorry, Ronic considering his old name. Then snowballing in. Where's the extra hit? No, Nightstalker has the void available. So Tuskar is down. Pycat, no spirits to jump with. The Bamboo just chumps himself forward. They'll get the Searing Chains and always want to fly. The Sunray's going to do a little bit of work, but Bamboo hits the avalanche into Sineko. Pycat just wants out. Leaves a spirit behind. There's no stuns to stop him. And he can just come straight back in front of Sineko if he wants to. That's why Diddy Ra pushes forward EGM. Keep going, man. Keep going. The Hellfire Blast. He actually got so far away that Na'Vi can't do anything against him. Pycat came back to his spirit, but what are they going to do? They're actually TPing to the tier 2 tower to try and catch up to Pycat. He's got a spirit in 1 second time. His flame guard's already up. And now with the Searing Chains, gets a little bit of space. They'll pick him up and throw him down. The Sleight of Fist will not be enough to dodge out this attack from Na'Vi. But they are now just turning this into a 5-man Dota with now 50 kills in 18 minutes.
Can't even count that many. That's like, how do I count that on my hands?
Just start taking other people's toes.
Yeah.
Now Na'Vi want to do Roshan.
Are they going to get Rosh?
It's possible because there's no Ember Spirit. Do they have enough damage for this? You are running a Razor. If your Wraith King does have 4 points up in crit, so maybe this is where you look.
They can travel in 10 seconds to the wagon at the bottom.
You're right, he got BT, didn't he, before he got the Battle Fury. Bamboo. Oh, they find always want to fly, pick him up. He'll end up stealing toss. Roshan's only halfway through it. Funnic silenced up. In comes Bamboo. Goodbye, Funnic. And where is Ember Spirit coming? He BTs himself the mid lane, but they're just chasing in. They're going ham all over Diddy Ra. Where's that Nova? Is on the cliff side, so a really nice position, but you've just got 4C&L. They're running up the hill towards NaVi. There goes your reincarnation again. Put it back on cooldown for another 2 minutes. And maybe there's a follow-up. The curse over on Dandy, allowing Bamboo to pop the razor. Always on a fly. He's spirit jumping himself away from the Ember Spirit. Lamau. And now the four star forward. You can't spirit jump from that. Not when the four star's there to help him. NaVi will lose four in the fight. They don't finish up Roshan. And now 4C&L will take it for themselves.
They got a pretty crappy Roche lineup themselves, but come on, Roche, get some Craggies. Craggy the face. Nope. But, yeah, I guess with the Wisp extra overcharge attack speed, could help a little bit, but yeah, this is taking a long time. Unfortunately, NaVi are going to be dead for a long time, but Sexy Bamboo is getting pretty low, but hey, you're against the Wisp.
ETM, man.
You're against the Wisp.
And Bamboo actually jumps out. So Ember Spirit will take the Aegis to the Immortal, they put it in the hands of PyCap. And if you, seriously, if you have any of your friends right now that are not watching this game, just go and slap them across the face. And then type into their console, just like, go on watch this game. Like, that's it. Get them on the Twitch live stream right now. Shit, spread the word. There's only game number one of this best of three series. So there's a lot of great Dota on tonight. And I'm watching over here.
Yeah, this is just amazing Dota watch. It's just constantly running at you, thinking that, oh, well, we have this, we can always do it. I mean, like I said, they kind of turned around a little bit because Rubick was able to steal some of the spells. Like, it has been helping a lot in the team fights. So Always Wanna Fly is definitely progressing a little bit better, but he's 3-9, poor guy. It's actually looking at all the stats. Who has the most? EGM has
look at
one
EGM.
Of the most.
He's like 12-8-17.
It's like the Suicide Squad. It's part of it.
It's not even something to suicide. Like that's the brilliant part of it. Yeah, he's died 8 times. Sure, 17 assists and 12 kills. Told you, man. Never question the balls of EGM, aka skill build.
I will always not question it. And it did add a lot of magic burst damage to the Tiny in the mid lane.
Okay, and Nine Sucker just got scouted out.
Doesn't matter though, he has full vision. Like, who's gonna even stop him? The only thing they have, essentially, is a Blink Dagger on Wraithing that could help. That's Night Stalker is just immortal right now.
Okay, so I was gonna ask the question, like, do you try and defend the top lane push, but they're already taking out the tier 2 tower. They TP in PyCat, who can spirit jump himself back out again. What have you actually got? So, in fact, Always on a Fly again gonna steal these spirits. The TPs are coming down to bottom lane. But you got a defensive relocate, you got a potential curse space creator from Nikwa. And this Night Stalker has been spending the last 2 minutes trying to find a target for them to kill. This game is just ground to a halt on killing.
I just don't see how NaVi are gonna get the kills. Like, this is all they have to do. That's the best thing about 4CL's lineup. They just run at you and
Dandy's
they win,
dead.
Or they split push you and win.
Dandy's actually dead. Like, they're gonna relocate in, as the damage just isn't there for the Night Stalker. Bamboo, grab a couple of centaurs on the side of Dandy.
Well, they're gonna be relocating back. This is potentially a lot of damage.
You got Nikwa here already, though.
Like, all
EGM, like, Nikwa is perfectly positioned to protect him. You got the BTs coming in as well from PyCat, so you get a pick up on Bamboo. Side of Fist controls up Rubick. He's got that spirit, but it's only right next to PyCat. The return then Searing chains is like I'm watching a Rubick Ember Spirit battle. As Ember, he is just out of range.
He's got Aegis though.
Yeah, he does. And he leaves it and die to the Nova. He'll survive through it. And the Nightstalker keeps the run going. Stuns over on the Phoenix, so there's no way he can get himself out. There's no Icarus dive anyway, and the side of Fist Searing chains. Diddy Ra will die right in front of his tier 3 tower, while 4C&L, five of their players just bearing down on top of him. There he goes. The Wraith King will pop once again. 148 seconds. Till he's got reincarnation back up. Had to lose the tier 2 tower. It's a bloodbath.
This is just brutal.
You know that custom game I really, really love? Blood Tournament? Like, this is Blood Tournament, right here.
This is just like... I don't know. It's one team trying to stand up. It's like an 11-year-old trying to stand up to, you know, a 15-year-old. It's just not happening. I mean, we're gonna keep running at you because we're a little kid, and that's what we like to do. Just like to wrestle all the time, but it's not working out. I mean, it's also like trying to challenge your dad, you know, to that wrestling or arm wrestle or something.
Dad will punish you every single time. All right, so how does NaVi do this? How do they win a fight? Be it 5-on-5 or be it like how do you create smoke ganks? Like maybe get a number advantage. How does NaVi do it?
The only synergy I talked about already in this game is Wraith King dying, and then Supernova coming on top. Every single one of these Novas have been poor, and that's not even Suneko's fault. That's just because they don't have enough lockdown and they don't have enough AoE. Like, what are they gonna do? Have lift? That doesn't do enough. Snowball potentially could set something up, but they just don't have enough setup for the Phoenix to actually work.
Nice Stalker is waiting for this. He wants to relocate assistance, and now he's gonna get it. Avalanche Toss will be there, and Didierara is down for the count. 42 seconds, but he does have buyback available. And NaVi are moving forward. They're trying to get the tether position again, but Wyvern, he cursed over on Tuska. They start the Nova. The Bamboo and Whisper already here to pick up. Ah, they kill him off before he finishes the job. EGM has a bloody Reaver. He's so bloody tanky. How do you stop that? He tethers away. That's how you do it. You steal 224 points of damage, and you find yourself a killer, Sandy. That's the way to do it. The Bamboo takes everything from you and gives nothing back. NaVi completely team wiped. 46 to 20 is now our kill counter. And that top tier 3 tower will be attacked in just a jiffy.
They could even go mid if they wanted to. I mean, all these lanes are pressured in. Not one tower. Did they even touch the towers? Yeah, they touched the towers at least, NaVi. They did something this game, but they unfortunately didn't take any of the objectives. That's just... I mean, they had a good setup there. It's just the Phoenix didn't have the Fire Spirits, and you saw with Overcharge how easy it is to clear up the Phoenix Egg, so...
I just can't believe I'm looking at a Wisp who's just walking around with a Reaver 26 minutes in with a Glimmer Cape. It's like... the tankiest support. But yeah, he has got more kills, though. He's just got more assists. Like, 13, 9, 23...
He also gets more attack damage because of that, too, because he's strength-based.
Cool.
Look at that, the right clicks. He's 113 damage on a Wisp with Overcharge. Yeah, that's the DPS, man.
you know, the funny thing is, like, I remember having a conversation with Dandy almost 4 years ago, and he was talking about the frustrations at the time about, like, getting his ideas drafted by Puppy. Because Puppy kind of like runs the, it's my ship, I kind of like, this is the best thing, we just do it. He really wanted to run Wisp as a solo mid, because he thought Wisp had more than enough damage and influence that could run him as a core. Just pointing out,
it's
113 points of base damage overall.
It's really good. Like, honestly, it's really good. It's just the scaling factor. You kind of need, like, two other good heroes. Okay, I'm trying to think of a situation where you can have, like, an offlaner, like, you know, a Void or something back in the day as the offlaner, and then you have another semi-carry or carry in the top lane. And then, yeah, Wisp. Wisp is great for that, because then you can... you just get the fast level 6. Like, we saw how potent that was this game. 6 minute, or 9 minute.
Oh, smoke break. Hyphenic gets the shards over from Nightstalker. This should be a gem. Into their hands, but Nightstalker, the Glimmer Cape, and the relocate out to safety. They took him all the way home.
They're High coming Cat back, Nickel. Too.
Yeah, they're coming
they're
to fight
coming
this. They really want this. Bamboo is going to hit the ground right now. No force up. They actually got the pickup of the telekinesis in the middle of it, but look at the cleave damage. They still can't kill him. The Nova Pop will help him. But double damage over on an Ember Spirit. They curse on Dandy. There's nowhere to go. He's literally being killed by his own team right now. The Raging Blade Mail will return a little bit of this damage, but when I say little, I mean little. Nightstalker needs a way down off this cliffside to have a problem where they relocated back onto. As well, the Shards do keep this fight split up. Suneko knows they're kind of isolated up here, but Diddy Rod's got nowhere to go. The Snowball will protect him for a moment, jumping in after EGM, but EGM protect again by this cold embrace. The slide of fist, it's all up to Pycat to do the work. The Tiny still down for the count, but now finally the Night Stalker down on the ground, and Phoenix down for the count. Rubick is the only one alive back at base because he respawned. And GG, finally the call is made. It has only taken 72 kills in 29 minutes. For NaVi will say, game number one of this best of three is over. 4C&L will take it.
That was just punished. And that's a drafting punishment, to say the least. That was really well played from 4C&L all around, man. It's just non-stop aggression. Maybe they lost because of that courier snipe at the beginning of the game. I can't believe that still happened. I'm still thinking about it here.
You mean the lack of courier snipe into a courier snipe?